is Professor Talia Jaripova. She got a PhD in Brown University in 1989, but she actually changed the major from electrical engineering to applied mathematics. It's amazing. And then she was a professor at the University of Wisconsin Madison since until 2000, and now she's a professor in the University of Texas at Austin since 1999, and she's a chair in mathematics since 2012, and she's now a science fellow since 2012. Today, she's talk about stochastic modeling and method in optimal portfolio construction.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me well? Okay. All right, so thank you so much, and also thank you for staying so late. So before I give, does it work now? Yeah? Okay. So before I give you the main part of my talk, I would like to start with a very brief review of how mathematics met finance and what came out of it. So financial mathematics is a highly interdisciplinary field. It sits on the crossroads of many areas: stochastic analysis, classical analysis, differential equations, finance, economics, decision analysis, statistics and econometrics. And it deals with the valuation of derivative securities, investments, and more broadly, the management of financial risks. And it started, I would say, in the late 70s with the pricing of derivative securities. So derivatives are contracts that are written on primary assets, and derivatives have been in human history forever. You can find derivatives in the Bible. You can find derivatives in Middle Ages, in the South Sea Bubble. I should say that even Isaac Newton lost a lot of money in derivatives during the South Sea Bubble crisis. And later on, derivatives became extremely popular in 1900 and last century and this century. Now, how to evaluate derivatives has been an open problem for a very, very long time. And the major breakthrough came in 1973. Black, Scholes, and Merton had this breakthrough idea that says if you build a portfolio that reproduces the payoff of the derivative, then the capital you need to set up this portfolio must be the price of the derivative. And this, as I said, this finance idea was a major breakthrough. However, if we did not have the mathematics, stochastic calculus, there was no way the idea of Black, Scholes, and Merton could have been implemented. And this is how mathematics met finance and the field of financial mathematics started. But before then, long time ago, in 1900s, there was the very first mathematical work that modeled the stock price. And this was done by Louis Bachelier. He was a student of Henri Poincaré. And he wrote the thesis on the stock price movement. And Bachelier was working at the stock exchange in Paris. And he observed that the increment of the stock has a positive drift, but also is proportional to the square root of the time elapsed between the two instances. And this alluded to the first model that is a stock price model that involves the Brownian motion. And of course, this work was totally shut down. Nobody paid attention to it for 5 decades. And it was Paul Samuelson who introduced Bachelier's model to economics. And as a matter of fact, Paul Samuelson improved the Bachelet model, and he proposed the log-normal model of stock prices, and this model was highly popular in Wall Street in the 80s. So what is the classical paradigm of a derivative? What was the model that really gave birth to financial mathematics? So a European call is a contract. So the contract has a time, zero capital T. Capital T is the expiration. Little T is the initiation of the contract. At capital T, you have a payoff. So you see that your prom is something that depends on this log normal stock price. And the valuation problem amounts to finding the price, let's call it CT, that you and I will agree. If I am the writer of the security and I promise this payoff to you, then at which price you and I will get into the contract. And as I said earlier, the derivatives valuation problem has been an open one for many, many centuries, and it was Black-Scholes and Merton that came up with the idea of replication. So it all comes down to a mathematical problem, which is the following. I give you a stochastic process, a random variable, which is the payoff of the derivative, and this is the ST minus K plus. I give you two stochastic processes, the stock price and the bond price, and you need to find two processes that represent the positions on these two assets, the stock and the bond, such that the portfolio you create matches exactly what you promise. Can you do that? If you can, then the stochastic process, that is the total value of the portfolio, gives you the price of the derivative. So it all comes down to this stochastic analysis problem. Now, how do you calculate the price of the derivative? The replication says exactly what I write up there. Sorry. So this was the idea of Black-Scholes and Merton. And already here, you need to use stochastic calculus because you cannot define the stochastic integral because this is a process of unbounded variation. This is also a process of unbounded variation, and the classical way of defining integral does not apply. Then you postulate a price representation of this form for a smooth function h. And then you use Itô's calculus. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but Itô's calculus basically is like classical calculus plus a correction term that comes from the infinite variation of the underlying Brownian motion. And if you put these two things together, this and that, you get that the price, this function h, solves a linear equation, and the European price is given by this. And this is how differential equations invaded the Wall Street, and this is how mathematicians got into it, physicists in the early 80s, 90s, and so on. Later on, this idea of pricing by replication was extended to a very general class of processes, the semi-marginal processes, and many times exact replication is not viable, so one needs to extend the theory to what is called the arbitrage free pricing theory. This is, I would say, a masterpiece in financial mathematics. It's a very beautiful stochastic analysis theory, and it gives you the price of derivatives if you don't have arbitrage. Arbitrage is a probabilistic statement in the markets that you have. It says that you cannot create something out of nothing. You cannot start with zero money and end with something that is positive. And there is, as I said, a very nice, very beautiful theory which gives you the price of the derivatives as a martingale of the future payoff. And this is not, I would like to stress, that this is not just a mathematical result. The entire derivatives industry depends on this new measure Q. So in derivatives, what is happening is that you change the measure from the historical measure to the pricing measure. The prices are linear, are conditional expectations, and this is the most general pricing theory we have. So this, the derivatives area grew, and you have not only practical applications, but you also have very nice mathematics from Martingale theory all the way to infinite, to stochastic, to linear stochastic PDE for the term structure of interest rates. Currently, I would say the research of derivatives moved more towards the concept of risk, especially after the financial crisis. But still, no matter what happened and no matter how much heat the mathematicians got, nobody can deny anymore that mathematics has invaded finance, the finance industry, and it is really there to stay because it contributes quite a bit. The other side of finance, and this is what I would like to talk to you about mainly today, is the investments. And investments are completely different from derivatives, because in derivatives you try to eliminate the risk. But in investments, the risk is your product and you want to exploit it. And what happens is, if you look at the area of derivatives, then you see that not only derivatives use highly quantitative methods, but also in the 80s and the 90s, the area of derivatives and academia and derivatives practice worked very well together. This was the golden era of financial mathematics. But if you look at investments, we don't have a good theory yet. The investments industry is not that quantitative. And this is a very good opportunity to build new models and new mathematical models and new techniques, and also really build the analog of the Black and Scholes theory for investments. And I think this is what is coming up now in our community. So when we talk about portfolio construction, what do we really mean? First of all, you need to have a criterion, and the criterion I'll talk about, it is what we call utility or a risk measure. Then you need to look at your market opportunities. So what is that you trade? What is your risk premium? Then you need to look at time, and time many times is your enemy, because you have long, short, medium, and infinitesimal horizons, depending on whether you have pensions, mutual funds, hedge funds, or even algorithmic trading. And then you have constraints, and the constraints can be path dependent, and there is not a good quantitative theory for these constraints. So what happens in academia in investments? What is, first of all, how do we model the investor's behavior? And this goes back to Bernoulli. And Daniel Bernoulli got into sort of an argument with his cousin, Nicolas Bernoulli, who proposed the very famous St. Petersburg paradox. And this is a game that gives an unreasonable infinite value. And Daniel Bernoulli actually argued that there's nothing wrong with the game. What is wrong is how we value, in terms of the satisfaction we have, the utility from this game. And Bernoulli was the first who alluded to the fact that utility functions should not be linear, but they should be concave. And this work was shut down for actually almost two centuries. It went through different phases and finally found the axiomatic construction of utility theory was done by Borgerstein and John Bonomi. So when we talk about the utility function, this is what you should have in mind. An increasing function that is concave, so the marginal utility diminishes. Now, it was Robert Merton who took this concept of utility and paired it with the stochastic optimization problem. And this is how portfolio construction was created in continuous time. So Merton proposed a way to value the performance of trading strategies and proposed what we call the value function here, which is the maximal expected utility given the filtration and given your initial endowment. And of course, this is a classical stochastic optimization problem, and these problems have been examined using two main methodologies. One, when you have local dependence, is Markovian models. You use dynamic programming principle, and this goes back to Bellman. When you have non-Markovian models, then you work with duality approach, which is actually a very well-known approach, even Lagrangian in mechanics. So just to give you a simple example, when you have Markovian models, that's a typical model of a stock price whose coefficient depends on a correlated factor, like stochastic volatility, for example. Your wealth is what we call a controlled diffusion process, and you write down the dynamic programming principle. This is actually a very deep result in stochastic optimization. This was founded by Bellman. And you have the infinitesimal expression of optimality, this Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation. So this equation is a very well-known equation in stochastic optimization, and from this you can get the optimal portfolio in what we call a feedback policy, a feedback form. Now, the problem with the Bellman equation, as you see, is that it is fully nonlinear, and for these equations we don't have many good results. And there are many problems, many difficulties because of the degeneracies, because of state constraint, because of lack of smoothness and so on. And there is a vast volume of papers in my area in which we examine the Bellman equation. The other approach, which applies to very general market models, is the duality. So you look at the dual of the utility, and this was introduced by Bismuth in 1975. And this is one of the duality approach, and the analysis of the portfolio problem through duality is one of the most active areas in financial mathematics. And there is a very nice, very natural connection with what we call price inflators. I really don't want to bother you with all these technicalities. All I want to say is that this process is X, represents wealth, and this process is Y, represents what we call the pricing kernels. And you have the primal problem, which is maximization overall wealth policies, and you have the dual problem, which is maximization overall dual processes Y. And they are very nice results, and the results connect to the primal and the dual problem. And also they give us a very beautiful connection between the two marginals and this random Nicodym derivative on what is known as the dual minimizer. So there's a lot of intuition in this nice formula here. So let's look at some extensions. And these are problems. If you have a graduate student who would like to work on this, please ask him or her to send me an email. They're quite interesting problems. Recently, a class of problems that has attracted a lot of attention is what we call delegated portfolio problems. And investors and managers interact. They have their own utilities. They both want to maximize their utilities, but have different objectives. And more importantly, they have different information. Investors and managers do not have the same information. However, investors pay the manager fees, and manager promises risk and returns to the investor. And a variation of this problem is the problem of two managers that compete against each other. They have different sigma algebras because they are familiar with different assets, and one tries to beat the performance of the other. This is a very nice problem. I think it will be an excellent direction for young people to work on. The other class of problems, and these are notoriously difficult, is when we pay transaction costs. When you pay any time you transact, because you follow a process of infinite variation, you are going to go bankrupt in finite time. In this case, you have to reformulate the problem through a singular control problem. You cannot transact all the time. So you need to formulate it correctly, otherwise you get no solution. And you formulate it as a singular control problem. The controls are these policies that represent buying or selling from, in this case I just wrote it as you buy and sell from the bank account, but you can You can put the transaction cost here and there, it doesn't really matter. What matters is that the Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman equation becomes a variational equality with gradient constraints. And we have done a lot of work on this. So far, we know how to deal up with, I would say, three stocks. But there are many nice problems that require multiple more than three stocks. And this is also, in my opinion, a very nice problem to work on. Another class of problems that is quite popular these days is the liquidation. Many times we want to unwind the position, and a big investor delegates the liquidation to what is known, to what we call a major agent. A major agent liquidates the position, and the major agent has to interact with noise traders and high frequency traders. And liquidation is a very delicate interplay between speed and volume. If you liquidate too fast, you might really have a very unfavorable price impact. But if you go too slow, you can have very unfavorable price fluctuations. And you can have a very nice mean field gain problem, because the two sets of traders, the noise trader and the high frequency trader, interact in a very delicate and very intricate way. Now, as I said at the beginning of the lecture, when you model a stock market, you start with a probability space. And in this probability space, it was observed by Frank Knight a long time ago that perhaps the probability measure is not known. In this case, you have what we call model ambiguity. And therefore, not only you have the risk of the investor toward the risk aversion of the investor, but you also have the ambiguity in the model. So the very first class of problems that dealt with this ambiguity was this, what we call the the worst case scenario. And this is the problem that was introduced by Dean Boer-Schmidt. Now, this problem, this family of models is not very realistic, because there is no way you can differentiate between a plausible model and a model that does not make a lot of sense. And this work was more recently generalized to this class of models, which includes a penalty, and this is right now the most active area, I would say, in mathematical finance. This is the what we call robust portfolio management. And a very popular choice of penalties is what we call an entropic penalty. And this is very much related to risk measures, Choquet integration. So there's a very beautiful theory behind this class of problems. Now, in order to analyze these problems, the best method is the duality, because you go from a supinfinite problem to an infinite problem. And as I said just a couple minutes ago, this is right now the most active area in our field. So what happens now in investment practice? Fund managers don't care less, as you can guess, if the Bellman equation has a unique solution or if there is no more than one probability measure. However, what they do makes a lot of sense. The problem, and if there is something I would like all of you to get out of my talk, the problem is right now academia is in one planet in investments and investment practices in another. And the question is, how do you put these two things together? Can you put these two things together? Of course we can. It happened with derivatives. It happened with interest rates, and I really think that it would be great if academia and investment practice merge. And this is happening slowly but surely, and there's a lot of interesting work to be done. So what do they do in practice? In practice, they use three things. They use either single period criteria. We have the mean variance criterion, or and the Black-Litterman, which is an improvement of the mean variance. or they use long-term criteria as if the horizon was there was long enough, and this is the Kelly criteria. But even though these three criteria give rise to solutions that are very tractable, there are many discrepancies in all these three criteria. It's actually quite scary because our pensions, our loans, our mortgages are managed basically by these three criteria, and there are major deficiencies in them. So what is the mean variance criterion? This is by far the most popular criterion in portfolio management. This was introduced by Harry Markowitz in 1952, and in this criterion the performance depends on the mean and the variance, so the utility in a sense depends on only two variables, two moments. So the mean variance optimization problem amounts to the following. You fix the maximum risk you are willing to take, and according to Markowitz, the highest risk was done through the variance, was modeled through the variance, and you try to maximize the return of your portfolio, or you set the lowest return that you are willing to accept, and you try to minimize the variance. These two formulations are identical. So this is the very popular, what you're going to see is very popular diagram. If you go to your fund manager, perhaps he or she has given you brochures with this kind of the picture that's going to come up now. So suppose that you fix the variance and you try to find the best mean that you can get for your expected returns. So you can see that this is the minimum return you can, excuse me, this is the, if you fix the variance, this is the optimal mean that you have. And if you do this for all the acceptable variances, then you get the shaded region that are the admissible portfolios. And there is a theory that was further developed by Markowitz and Sharp that says that the best portfolios, according to certain financial economics criteria, are the ones that lie on the upper part of the what we call the efficient frontier. So fund managers basically do this thing. They have static models and they try to solve a Markowitz over and over and over. And there are major deficiencies in this model. So first of all, there's a huge model error. You have to forecast the mean rate of return of the stock price. This is a very difficult problem. The estimation error is very high, and not only the estimation error is very high, but also the solution of the problem depends heavily on this error. And I would like to make a point that in derivatives, we don't care about the mean rate of return of the stock because the risk has been eliminated, and therefore the mean rate of return of the stock does not enter into the picture. And this is, in my view, the fundamental difficulty with investments. How do you deal with this? Now, some of these difficulties have been alleviated by the Black and Litterman model, which was an improvement on Markowitz, because many times we have a better estimate of what is going on for assets that we are familiar with. And basically, this is what happens in practice. In practice, fund managers are not familiar with everything. They are familiar with certain classes, and then they inject their own personal views on how this asset class is going to do. The other thing, and this is a very nice mathematical problem, is what we know as time inconsistency of the mean variance problem. What is this? Suppose that you set the variance at zero for two periods ahead, and you solve the problem. This will give you the optimal policy at zero and the optimal policy at capital T, right? So this is the optimal portfolio for first investment period and then the optimal portfolio for the second investment period. Now, if you play the same game, but you set the same variance at 2T, but you set it at capital T, so you set it at only one period ahead of you, even though you have the same target, then you will see that these two our policies are not the same. And this is a major deficiency of the problem. In a sense, the policies you have don't have the same group property. So if you try to combine portfolio optimization problem with derivatives, and derivatives are conditional expectations, and therefore they have the same group property, you get into tremendous difficulties in reconciling the policies you use from the two classes. And as I said, this is not only a problem in the investment industry, this is also a problem, a very nice mathematical problem. We had actually a talk here in this conference on time inconsistent problems. The last difficulty is the fact that Markowitz is one people. So what they do in practice, and as I said, it's quite worrisome that our wealth, our earnings, our pensions, our loans are most of the times managed by this very primitive criteria. So what we need to do is to take Markowitz and make it dynamic. So what do I mean? I mean, solve the Markowitz and invariance problem for one period, then set the target for the next period, then set the target for the other period and keep going. Can you do that? Well, we don't know. This is an open problem. And this is not the same problem as setting the variance for three periods ahead. No. You have to set it once and then again and again. So you have to go forward in time. And this is an open problem. And in my view, this is the heart of investment theory. Can we really do that? Can we come up with the term structure, if you like, a continuous time limit of this kind of construction? Of course, you can say, well, can I pair this dynamic, so to speak, multi-period construction to expected utility optimization, what academia does? And the answer is no, because in utility theory, you have a stochastic optimization problem at terminal time, and the dynamic programming principle gives you the solution backwards in time. But here, what we want to do is to put Markowitz one after the other, and go forward in time. And you can see that conceptually, these two things do not add up. One goes this way, the other goes that way, and the only time they can reconcile is if they are a single period. So, in my view, this is the heart of the problem. We don't have a good conceptual, foundational, model-independent investment theory precisely because of these difficulties. Now, is there any hope? So can you really reconcile academic literature and investment practice? And if you look, first of all, at the criteria, in practice, they have mean variance. Basically, you have the mean and the variance as criteria, two moments. They don't capture much. On the other hand, utility, as beautiful as it is for a criterion, it's a very elusive concept. You don't go to your fund manager and say, my utility is a power function with power 0.83. You don't do that. You have certain aspirations, you have certain hopes, you say, I'm willing to get between 3 and 5% at this point of my life. Maybe 5 years later, this will change. So you really have to have a dynamic structure of your preferences, a dynamic structure of how you process past dependence, past performance, and so on. So in a sense, not only you have to work on the criteria, but you also have to really understand what does it mean to have a truly dynamic criteria? And if you look at the practice is just single period. If you look at the academia, we have a continuous time criterion, but it doesn't contribute much because even if you know how to set an expected utility problem for a fixed horizon, what do you do after that? It doesn't really capture what the needs of investment practice are. And now I would like to proceed with a commercial break and talk to you about my work. And My work, this is a long-term project with Marek Michela, who is one of the founders of the BGM model, which is a model of interest rates widely used in Wall Street. This is actually something we started in 2002 and keeps going. And all these issues that I presented earlier between, for the discrepancies between academia and investment practice and so on, prompted us to define, to introduce, to build a new theory for expected utility or for investment performance. And this is what we call a forward utility theory, a forward investment performance. So what we did was we said, well, in a model independent way, you don't worry about it, this is just a very general, the most general model you can have in the market. How should I think about the performance of my investment strategies? So first of all, if I want to bring together the investment industry and the academic theory, I need to have a much more flexible structure to value the performance of portfolios. A utility at a single point is not going to do the job. And also a Markovitch in a single period is also not going to be helpful. And it's not helpful. So first of all, the classical expected utility approach has to be modified, has to be abolished in many ways, has to be turned upside down. And it took us quite some time to understand that what you really need is, you need to have a process that is defined for all times, that follows the filtration of the market, not just a deterministic utility exogenous to the market as it is in the classical financial economics, but you need to have a process that moves with the market. As market moves, you update your preferences, and this process has to satisfy this optimality principle. So basically, this is like going to the heart of dynamic programming, but now you don't do dynamic programming backwards, but you do it forward. Can you do that? And actually, this is quite a hard problem. But investment industry needs performance criteria like this. It does not need backwards performance criteria. They are not practical. They don't capture anything that we want to do. So does such a process exist? And this is actually a very difficult problem. It's an imposed problem. And you can, if you go to the heart of the definition, you basically see that what you need to do is you need to construct a super martingale away from the optimum and a martingale at the optimum. And it turns out that this utility process satisfies what we call an infinite dimensional, a stochastic partial differential equation. Now, what is this? Basically, this is an expression that tells you that the object you want to construct, this process U of x comma t, within the class of ITO processes, ITO processes are processes that have a drift and a volatility, this utility theory has to satisfy this stochastic PD. So given a volatility that it is up to the investor to choose, the drift of the stochastic PD must have this form. Can you solve this problem? And we have partial results. What is novel here is not only the forward construction of the utility process, but also the presence of what we have here, the volatility process of the investor. And in practice, when you talk to fund managers, what they tell you is, we don't know, given the uncertainty of the market, given the path dependence, given the past performance, how are we going to diffuse Markovitz for the next period? So, let me go back here, sorry for that. It's not easy to... I'm sorry for that. So basically, what the volatility does in the utility process, the volatility diffuses these variances from one period to the next. Sorry for this back and forth. It's very good to move forward. After all, this is what we have been working on. Now, let's take the case that the volatility of the investor is zero. This is the simplest case, and even in this case, there are many, delicate interplays between the preferences and the market. So when the volatility is zero, what happens? The stochastic PDE reduces to this very simple expression. So here you are looking for a utility process that solves this equation. Because the utility is concave, you're looking for a decreasing process in time. And it turns out that if you solve this imposed problem that has a solution u, deterministic u, and you subordinate time, you have a random time change here, then this process, which is the compilation of this deterministic function and this process A, is actually a forward performance process. Now, the intuition here is the following. Lambda is the risk premium. This is what you try to exploit. And the higher the risk premium, the better the market. So you see here that this random time change depends on the size of the risk premium. If you don't exploit the market, AT is an increasing process, U is decreasing in time, and therefore the performance of your portfolio drops. Now, it turns out that in order to solve this problem, you can actually use a quantity that in investment practice has a lot of meaning, and this is what we call risk tolerance. And risk tolerance is the ratio of the first marginal and the second marginal of the utility function. And it turns out that in this forward approach, the risk tolerance solves what we call a fast diffusion equation. And if you solve the fast diffusion equation, then you can come up with a system that gives you the optimal wealth and the optimal portfolio. Now, what is the meaning of this? The meaning of this is that the utility as such has been removed. And in investment practice, nobody really cares about utility. In investment practice, the quantity that carries a lot of financial intuition is right here. So you see that if you know your risk tolerance, which turns out to solve the fast diffusion equation, then you can have a system that gives you the optimal wealth and your optimal portfolio. And this is quite an astonishing result, mainly because you can have an entire construction for the forward case with zero volatility. You can show that you can move from the nonlinear equation that gives you the dynamic risk preferences, to a fast diffusion equation that gives you your risk tolerance, to an imposed heat equation that gives you your wealth process. This is increasing, so the marginal is positive. It also solves the heat equation. You can use Wither's theorem to characterize the solutions to this problem, which is equivalent to this and equivalent to that. And then you can have the entire construction. And to our knowledge, we don't know of any other stochastic optimization problem with this very general model with path dependence, but still you get a very nice, very crystal clear expression for the optimal wealth and the optimal portfolios through these harmonic functions H. Now, I want to spend two more minutes. As I said 10 minutes ago, in practice, they use mean variance and Black-Ritterman, and then the Kelly criterion. And the Kelly criterion is a criterion that is used as if the horizon was were very, very, very long. Now, in practice, you don't have one period, but you also don't have a very long horizon. So is there a way to create through this new approach that we put, we have constructed, can you come up with a model that produces as an optimal policy the one that is for the Kelly criterion? And this is actually something that took our time for almost 2 years, and the answer is yes, if you know how to set up the model correctly. So you can look at the model in which you have model uncertainty, you have model ambiguity, and then you, first of all, you have to extend the forward theory when you have more than one probability measures. And already to come up with this definition was by no means trivial, because this amounts to solving an equals SPD for a zero-sum stochastic differential game. So the question now is, can we find through this forward approach that we have constructed a case of a criterion that produces what they use in practice? And the answer is yes. Actually, you can show that, and I'm running out of time, I just want to mention that you can show that if you have a forward criterion of logarithmic type and a penalty criterion of quadratic type, then the optimal policy you get is what they use in practice. And to our knowledge, there is no theoretical justification for the Kelly criterion that fund, especially hedge fund managers, use all the time. And you have it right here. So this this optimal policy that we get here is what they use in practice. And what is the quantities that appear here are the following. Lambda hat is the best estimate that you have. Delta is your confidence in this estimate. So you see that this delta goes to infinity, then basically this goes to 1 and this goes to the Kelly criterion. If your confidence in the estimation goes to 0, then basically you deleverage. So let me just summarize where we stand. So through this new theory that we are putting forward, we have many questions, both in terms of the academic research and both in terms of the investment practice. So for the academic point of view, there's a lot of work to be done to analyze the stochastic PDE. And we need to understand existence, uniqueness, Markovian representation. This is actually a very beautiful problem for your graduate students, and also ergodicity of portfolios and so on. In investment practice, you have to reconcile what you get from the forward approach with mean variance. We have almost done that. Black-Littleman, this is a very nice filtering problem, but in an imposed forward way. You reconcile with Kelly criterion, and our hopes, and this is what we're working on, is to use this new, if you like, normative approach to reconcile what happens in practice with what academia can offer. So that's it. Thank you.
Backward,
so at some point the backward has to become forward.
Yeah, full structure is a backward, and then they are framed, this method in certain way can be forward. They are considering the shape of the thing.
Okay, another question. Okay, it's been a long, long time. I'm not actually doing finance mathematics, but I learned so many things. And it was a very, very great talk. And please give her big, big hand. Thank you so much.